Hi, everyone. Happy Monday. Did you like saying happy birthday to Mac? Yesterday was his 12-year-old birthday, so it's hard for us to believe. We got him when he was a tiny puppy. He was actually born at a working ranch in eastern Colorado. His mom was a herding dog, a horse herding dog on a working ranch, and he was like the littlest guy in the litter, the super calmest guy in the litter. So we picked him, and he's been our dog ever since. So hopefully you guys saw the Instagram post yesterday, and he's just an amazing garden dog, and I hope that you have your best friend, companion, furry friend as well. So everyone say happy birthday to Mac, and we took him for a little walk and actually gave him a little bit of our homemade pizza crust last night just to tell him happy birthday, right? So I hope you guys are having a great Monday so far and had a great weekend. It's a beautiful springish day today, around 70 degrees. Hopefully the weather's warming up where you live. I saw someone in the chat before the live stream actually had frost this weekend. So you northern gardeners, hopefully things are clearing up and cooling off. And I know you southern gardeners like Patricia down in Arizona, she said it was 90 degrees there today. That's crazy. She was out in the garden and just burning up there. So hopefully things are going to kind of even out and we're able to get our gardens planted. We've been doing a ton of planting, ton of cleanup. The garden is starting to look really good. And today we're going to talk about peppers, how to grow a ton of peppers in your garden. Got a couple tips for you that will hopefully help you grow more this year than you did last year. And welcome to Smart Pots. They're here. Happiest of birthdays to Mac. A lot of happy birthday wishes to Mac, so I'm sure he appreciates it. And we'll give him a couple extra treats for you all, okay? V says it's 93. That's crazy. Let me just say hello to people who are here today. Chanel, hello, Kim and Gardening Family. Lori Olson, hello from a gorgeous day in Colorado. By the snakes. The snakes are by the back door. Oh my goodness. I hope that's not really the case, but hopefully you can scare them off. Tanya's Townhouse, welcome. Kimberly Fortner, welcome. Matthew, hello. Lemmy, great to see you here. And you SoCal people, I'm sure you're enjoying this beautiful weather. Terry's here, 808 from Hawaii, Ramona. Cliff and Nisha, of course, are moderators. Just great to have you all here today. So get your pepper questions ready. And I also want to hear your favorite varieties of peppers. I absolutely love growing peppers. It's one of my favorite things to grow. And I think one of the reasons is because they come in so many different colors, shapes, and sizes. And I always enjoy planting the rainbow in the garden, planting my favorite colors, and having all that colorful, all those colorful peppers on my food. So I would love to hear your favorite varieties, from sweet all the way on up to hot. We tend to like them. Well, Jerry definitely likes sweet peppers more. I can handle a mild heat, a jalapeno, or maybe one step spicier than that. But much spicier than that, I'm not, I don't do that. But I know a lot of people love those super hot, spicy peppers. So let us know in the chat your favorite varieties. It's always fun to try new varieties. And I've got a bunch planted. Let me just start from the top here. We'll cover kind of the pepper basics. And then I'll tell you where I have my peppers planted. The pepper basics, really, for those of you that are brand new to growing peppers, they are a warm weather vegetable. They do like the heat. So 70 to 90 degrees, they do the best. They like full sun for the most part. So I've got some planted in the fountain raised bed planter there right behind me, because that is the sunniest spot in our garden. It gets the most sun of any spot. Our other raised beds are kind of around the edges of the garden, and they might get shaded like by the trees or by the fences or that type of thing throughout the day. So if you've got a full sun spot, that's really the best place for planting peppers. And by full sun, I mean 6 to 8 hours or more. Les, I just see here, super chat. Thank you. Wow, that's really nice of you. $4.99. Got drip pretty much reset up from winter storage in all of our raised beds. Onion starts and celery planted, and some beets started from seed. So you're going to town there. I think you're in the Pacific Northwest, if I recall correctly, which is a perfect time to plant all of those vegetables, the cool weather veggies. So thank you so much for the super chat. Really appreciate you showing your support that way. So with the peppers, if you have a full sun area, that's really the best spot that you can plant them. Like I mentioned, I planted a whole bunch of varieties in that middle planter there. And if you saw my Instagram story this morning, you saw a little video of how they really like to be planted close together. I'm going to talk more about that in just a moment. However, if you don't have a full sun spot, you can also plant them. I've got several planted right in here. this probably gets about a good 6 hours of sun, maybe a little bit more as the summer approaches, but they also do really well in that type of sun situation as well. So I've got three plants back in here. I've got two that I actually overwintered. They do grow over the winter in mild climates pretty well, and you can actually overwinter them by mulching them heavily at the base. They don't produce during the winter, but these are actually two plants from last year. So they're just putting on new leaves, and I've got one new plant that I just put in when we did this raised bed maybe 3 or 4 weeks ago. So definitely plant them in full sun. If you don't have a big spot to grow them, you can grow them in containers. The Smart Pots containers are ideal for peppers. You can usually do 1 to 2 plants in a 5 gallon, like the Calikim 5 gallons, the little orange one that's back there. That's a 5 gallon. Or you can plant 3 or 4 plants in the 10 gallons. Or if you've got the little shorty raised beds, the Smart Pots little shorties, you could probably fit, I want to say, even maybe 2 plants in each little section. They like to, or in each little section, and then support them with a cage. So you can really fit a lot of peppers into a small space, which is really nice to grow a ton of peppers. So let me, and there's lots of info, by the way, you guys, if you want more info on peppers and you don't have this book, I would grab it. There's a whole section in here on growing peppers and also warm weather vegetables versus cool weather vegetables. But the section here will teach you how to plant them, how to grow them, how to harvest them, and some different ways to use them in recipes, as well as some of my favorite varieties. So grab this. It'll be a good resource for you too. So that's just kind of some pepper basics. If you've never grown peppers from seed and it's your very first year doing that, I do encourage you to grow them from seed, because you can really grow the rainbow. You can find a ton of variety of different types of peppers that you can grow from seed, much more than if you go to the garden center and pick up transplants. Perfectly okay to do that, but I love to grow them from seed. And we've got a pepper seed collection on our website that's got 5 different varieties, as well as a tomato pepper collection if you want to kind of mix and match with tomatoes and peppers. That's a good one to grab if you're just starting out. But the key to growing them from seed and getting them to germinate is make sure that you're using, or you're growing them in a warm spot, or you're using a heat mat to really raise the temperature of your seedling tray. So a heat mat is relatively inexpensive. I think these run around $15 or so on Amazon. Really makes the difference with being able to germinate peppers. They like that bottom heat. And this just raises the temperature a little bit on your seedling tray, so they germinate much quicker. They can take a couple of weeks to germinate, especially the hot peppers. So this really does help speed up germination. And when I started using a heat mat for my peppers, it was a game changer. So highly recommend one of these. The link's in the video description. If you're going to be starting from seed, you're going to be using a heat mat a lot. So it's definitely a worthwhile investment, especially when growing peppers. And by the way, eggplant are the same way. They pretty much have the same type of growing conditions as peppers. So peppers and eggplant, the same really applies for both of them. Now, the heat really raises the temperature up and gets those seedlings off to a fast start. So you want to start your pepper seeds indoors. You can start them indoors anyway, about 8 to 10 weeks before your last frost date, which hopefully we're all way past that. So if you haven't started your pepper seeds yet and you live in a southern climate, I would definitely say there's still time to get pepper started from seed, because we've got a long growing season. I can pretty much get pepper harvests up until November sometimes, and even into December, depending on the weather here in Southern California. If you're in a northern climate, you might be a little bit on the late side to start from seed. And Cliff, you can let us know in the chat how that is in your growing climate, because I know you have a lot shorter of a season. So if that's the case for you, you may want to go ahead and pick up some pepper transplants at the garden center just to get some planted. And then next year, make sure you start early enough so that you can get some in the outdoors as soon as the weather changes and starts to get warm. Then you have plenty of time to get harvests before the weather turns cold in the September, October timeframe. Okay, so kind of a little few basics about peppers. Let's jump into the chat here and see what questions you might have. And in the meantime, make sure that you pop your favorite pepper varieties. We'll kind of take a poll and see which one wins out and which one is your favorite. I know one of my favorites is California Wonder. It's in a lot of my different seed collections, the pepper, I'm probably the raised bed in the spring garden seed collection, I'm pretty sure. And that's what this plant is right here. And it's a really beautiful red pepper, nice thick-walled pepper, absolutely delicious on the grill. So if you're looking for a winner, that's definitely my favorite. Okay, let's see here in the chat, what's your favorite and what questions you might have about peppers. Okay, Debbie from Hawaii. How you doing, Debbie? My orange bells from the April pizza box just germinated. Looking forward to trying them. Okay, Debbie, I'm really glad that you're enjoying those. And I believe that's actually a purple pepper, but it's going to be beautiful on your pizza, and super excited that they've germinated, that they're doing well. And I think they're going to do really, really well in your climate there in Hawaii. And I'm really glad that you've got your box and they are going strong. So that's awesome. Shalina, my favorite are Serranos. I'm trying the Cali Kim Hungarian hot wax this year. So Selena, that one is a hot one. So hopefully you like hot peppers. That's great to put in salsas. Even for me who likes a more milder to medium salsa, I'll put a few of those in there, but they definitely grill up really nicely. And when you grill them, it kind of soften them a little bit. It really does make the spice a little bit milder, but those are very prolific. So be prepared for lots of peppers. And I think one of our favorite ways to eat peppers is hot pepper jelly too. Our son Drew loves the hot pepper jelly. So I do try and grow some of the hots, a lot of jalapenos, because that makes really nice pepper jelly. If you're into that, I highly recommend growing a lot of hot peppers, because it does take a lot to make that jelly. So glad they're doing well for you. Okay, Stephanie, how are you doing today? Glad to have you here. What is the best size smart pot for a single eggplant? I have several this year and want to do them in pots versus in my raised beds. I would say you want to do at least a 10 gallon, and I would only put one eggplant in there. Eggplant, especially the Black Beauty eggplant, which is one of my favorite varieties, can get quite large. So I would suggest a 10 gallon, which I have on my website, even a 20 gallon would do well for the Black Beauty eggplants as well. Some of the other varieties are a little bit smaller, like the Japanese eggplant and the Lista de Gandia that's in my eggplant seed collection. Those plants tend to be a little bit smaller. So you could probably get away with, I would probably still do a 10 gallon for those. They don't get as huge and ginormous as the Black Beauty does, but a 10 gallon will still get plenty of room for the roots. And the more room you have for the roots, the better and the more eggplant you're going to get. So I would definitely recommend at least a 10 gallon, unless you're growing a smaller variety, like the Patio Baby is a smaller variety, which you could get away with a 5 gallon for that. Okay, lots of good peppers flying by here. Linda, I grow all the peppers hot and sweet. It's always great to grow the rainbow. V is growing purple, orange, red cayenne. That's a real hot one too, at least for me anyway. Red cayenne, and just scrolled by here. Oh, shishito, Anaheim, banana. Wow, you've got lots of peppers there, V. You're gonna have a beautiful little garden there with all your peppers. They're just so pretty. Sometimes they're so pretty, I have a hard time picking them, which I know is kind of crazy, but I love to look at them. Tina started from seed, way to go. You're gonna have a beautiful variety there. And 808 Ladybugs is trying to get peppers going so you can make jelly. So yeah, I think that's really fun. It's fun to make them in the cute little jelly jars and give them away for Christmas. And you can also freeze them whole, by the way, too. So if you have a lot of them, you can freeze them until you're ready to make your jelly. They're not gonna come out of the freezer nice and crisp, but they'll be, you know, softer use for recipes and for jellies. Okay. Next tip about growing peppers is don't transplant them outdoors too soon. And I am totally guilty of this myself. And actually, it's been a little tough this year because our weather has been so up and down. But they really do best when you transplant them outdoors when the nights are in the high 50s or the 60s. Sometimes if you get them out early, they really just don't do too well. If the weather's not, or if the temperature of the soil isn't warm enough and the weather's not warm enough, they'll just kind of sit there for a little bit. They won't do a whole lot. They won't grow a whole lot until the weather warms up. And sometimes that can even stunt them a little bit to where they never quite take off. And then the peppers you get outside in the nice warm nights and warm days will take off and catch up quickly. But this year, it's been a little bit challenging because I know a lot of us have had really big temperature swings. So typically, I'll get my first peppers planted around the first day of spring, which this year was March. Well, I guess every year is around March 20th or 21st. But this year, we were a full month late because of the weather. So I got them planted out a couple weeks ago. And then, of course, it dropped down into the 40s for a good solid week to 10 days at night. So you know what? You do the best you can with the weather. You follow the tips, and sometimes it works. Sometimes the weather throws us a little monkey wrench, which it has this year. But if it does really drop down, you want to have some covers handy. Like if you're getting close to freezing, or even if you drop below 40, I would try and cover your peppers if you can. And you could use like the little plastic winter covers like we have videos on. You can use those big like 10-gallon. If you've got trees and planted trees this year and you have those nursery big pots left over, you can cover them with those. Put a little storage bin over them to protect them from the cold on those cold nights. So definitely get the covers ready in case you have some really big temperature swings. Now, you don't need to bury their stems. If you've heard me talk about tomatoes, when we're planting tomatoes, I often talk about you plant the tomatoes deeply because the tomatoes have those little hairs on them that will develop roots. Peppers aren't like that. You can pretty much plant them at soil level. If you plant them a little bit deeper, it's okay, but you don't need to. But I try and plant my little seedlings pretty much at soil level. For example, here's some that are waiting to be planted and actually got attacked by some little cabbage loopers, so we've sprayed for that. But when I take them out of these little 1-gallon pots to transplant them, I'll just dig them out and then plant them in my raised bed to where the soil level on the transplant pot is the same as the soil level in the raised bed. So no need to bury them deeply. They'll be just fine planted at soil level. Now, if you want your peppers to mature a little bit earlier, you could plant the sweeter varieties do mature earlier than the hot varieties. And they also will germinate sooner when you start them from seed indoors. So sometimes hot varieties can take up to 3 weeks to germinate. Sweet varieties usually will germinate in 7 to 10 days, depending on the temperature where you're growing them. So first tip, use a heat mat. Second tip, don't transplant outside too soon. Just be patient, wait for the weather to get warm enough, and then keep your winter covers handy in case you do have that last minute cold snap. Always keep an eye on the weather. If you're a gardener, keep an eye on that weather app and see how the temperatures are gonna be, especially now, kind of during the season when you're planting, you've got tender seedlings out there that might not be super established and have the root structure to really stand up to the temperature swings and the weather when the weather throws crazy stuff your way. Okay, let me see here in the chat here what's going on, if you have any questions. Jenna, great idea. I'm trying peppers on one level of my original green stock this year. They were great in green stocks. When we visited Gary out the rusted garden, we planted a bunch of peppers on a video in his green stock, and they do well. It's a great little tiered growing system, and peppers do very, very well. They actually grow really well in small spaces. So actually, I'm going to talk about that. Oh, you know what? I meant to talk about that with this last little point here. So one thing I really like about peppers, you can grow a lot in your garden because you can plant them very close together. Again, check out my Instagram post from today because I planted, I want to say about 10 right back there. You can plant them. In fact, I prefer to plant them about 8 to 10 inches apart because when the weather gets hot, they're very susceptible to something called sun scald on the pepper fruit itself. So they like the hot temperatures, but especially when the plants are newly developing, they can almost get like a little sunburn on the peppers themselves. So when you plant them close together, it really helps, not only because you'll get more production out of your pepper planter, but it will shade the pepper plants themselves and help them from getting that sun scald. And if you've ever gotten that on your plants, it's almost like a sunburn. It's like a brown or can be a black spot on your pepper. The skin and the wall of the pepper really thins out. Sometimes it can get a little hole in there, which can cause mold and pests can get in there. So it's something you want to avoid when you can. Now, when you harvest your peppers that have sun scald, you can cut that spot off. As long as it's not moldy or anything like that, you can go ahead and eat your pepper. But it's definitely something you want to avoid if you can. And planting them close together really, really does help. I do like to use these little tomato cages for support. Now, These really don't work for a tomato, but they will work perfectly for peppers. They're readily available. They're very inexpensive. You can find them at the garden center. And I like to sometimes kind of paint the cages different colors. I've got these ones red and yellow. You can easily paint them, and just to kind of make your garden bed a little bit more exciting and pop with color. So let me hear now back to the chat. And what do you like to use to support your pepper plants too? Because I'm sure there's lots of different things and creative ideas that people like to use. That's one thing I love about this chat is everyone is offering up their ideas and suggestions, and it just makes it a lot of fun. Okay, a question from Tracy M. What's with all the gnats? They're in LA County, Riverside County in great numbers. And we have seen a lot more gnats flying around this year. I'm pretty sure it's because of all the rain we've had. We never have this much rain. Although I do always see a lot of gnats and whiteflies about this time of the year. So hopefully as we go throughout the weather gets warmer and it's not as humid. We are going to be getting rain and lightning even into next week, which is kind of crazy. We never have that this time of year. Hopefully the populations will subside. I've been doing lots of pest control videos, so go back and watch those if the pests are chewing holes in your plants. Just did one last week on the Captain Jack's. It was a few weeks ago on the dead bug brew, and it really works well to help with holes in your leaves. So like I said, I'm having that issue with this, and I just sprayed it with Captain Jack's yesterday, and it's already starting to kill some of the bugs on here. So it really does work quickly. Oh, here's a plant. Here's a little leaf here that the bugs are already dying. There were some aphids on here, some cabbage loopers. So Captain Jack's dead bug brew really works great. But I would recommend that you head over to bonide.com. They've got a great little resource over there. It's a pest and disease problem solver. And you can look up what issue you're having, help you identify the pest, and then help you identify a product that you can use that will help with that. So highly recommend that. They've got lots of organic products as well. So hopefully that helps. Okay, Christina Cookson, my peppers and eggplant from seed are still very small. I hope they will grow a lot more once I get them into the garden. Okay, Christina, you may want to make sure that they are in a warm spot in your house. I know when the temperature is cold outside, our house tends to be much chillier. My grow light station under my stairs is a whole lot warmer. I stick them under there under grow light, under a heat mat or on top of a heat mat, and you can really see a difference. They really take off. So if you can get them in a warmer spot in your house to help them come to size, and so they'll be larger before you pop them outside. And of course, make sure that you harden them off. And then once you do get them transplanted, I do like to cover them a little bit with shade cloth, just for a couple of days until they kind of get established, to kind of get them slowly used to the outside. Even though I've hardened them off already, the transplant process can sometimes be a bit of a shock for them. Okay, let's head into tip number three for growing a ton of peppers in your garden this year, and that is consistent watering and feeding is super important, especially for the peppers, because they have more shallow roots, a lot shallower than your tomato plants or like your watermelon or things like that. The roots are fairly shallow, so you do want to make sure that you're consistently watering them so they don't dry out, and they don't let the soil dry out more than an inch below the surface is kind of my general rule of thumb in a raised bed or in your in-ground garden. Containers are a whole different animal. They can dry out very quickly. Once your containers dry out, it's super hard to get them hydrated again. I'll have to immerse them or set them in a tub of water to help them really soak up from the bottom and help the soil really get saturated. So really do be diligent with watering your container plants. And during the hot temperatures, you may need to check your containers daily, even twice a day, and have your drip schedule set a little bit differently for your containers. Containers need feeding about once a week, and you will see a huge difference if you set your container schedule to feeding every 7 to 10 days. I should say 7 to 10 days. Notice a huge difference on that with your production in your containers. Raised beds, I would say every 2 to 3 weeks are good for fertilizing, but you do need to check and make sure that if you have drip irrigation, that it's set to the schedule where your soil is getting good and saturated. This raised bed here, I always have a little bit of a issue with it drying out because it's kind of at the end of our drip system, so it doesn't quite have the water pressure that the beginning of the system has. So I do tend to mulch this one a little bit heavier to keep the moisture in, and then I check it a couple of times a week just to see if I need to give it some supplemental water. there. So definitely be checking your peppers, especially on a regular basis, to make sure they're not drying out. And then about, you know, halfway through the growing season, you can add some more compost and worm castings to your garden beds around the bottom of your plants, and water that in really well. My book on raised bed gardening has my full fertilizer schedule, what I do throughout the season. So it's super, super helpful. It has a schedule for like a month in, a couple months in, like a mid-season boost, and then an end of season boost. So it's really helpful. And I've noticed a huge difference with consistent watering and feeding in the production of your plants. So definitely keep that up, and you're sure to have a ton of peppers for all the different recipes and to put on your dinner plate and even to share with friends. I think nothing more fun than bringing a little basket of peppers over to someone, because they just kind of make a pop in the garden. It's, you know, you can have different colors, and then when you bring it to a friend, they're like, wow, all these beautiful colors and shapes. And it's just kind of makes for a really unique, fun garden gift. And maybe, you never know, it'll get them into growing peppers as well. So let me know if you like to do that too. And also, if you've seen a difference when you're consistently fertilizing and watering your peppers, as opposed to when you kind of forget about them and aren't really being too consistent with it. Okay, let's pop back into the chat here, see what's going on. I still want you to put your favorite pepper varieties in here, and we'll maybe get some new varieties going here. Let's see, a lot of people saying, drip irrigation is a huge game changer, definitely. I know I'd be totally lost without it. The cool thing about it is too, it really does free up your time for doing other fun things that you'd wanna do, like maybe, you know, start some new plants, maybe build a new raised bed or a new trellis or something like that. So it frees up your time and allows you some freedom from your garden if you wanna go on vacation, especially in the summertime. And Gardener Tom, thank you so much for bringing that up. Mulch your peppers. Absolutely. It will help protect their roots from getting overheated. So I always mulch when I plant, because if I don't do it when I plant, I tend to forget and don't go back and do it later. Definitely will protect them in the heat and protect them in the cold if you do have those occasional cold nights, or if you're trying to get them out in the garden just a little bit early. That mulch definitely helps. Back here, I've got some shredded leaf mulch. I also love the shredded straw mulch, or you can buy a big straw bales and shred it up yourself, but always collect your leaves. Even go to the park and collect leaves however you can. It's a great free resource. We recently collected a whole bunch of leaves around the side of our yard and put them in a big 100-gallon compost sack right down here so that we can easily grab mulch and then spread it around the garden whenever I need it. So it's been a super convenient way to collect the leaves. Okay, Aussie Agogo, how are you today? Last year, the roots of all my peppers in my raised beds kept exposing themselves. I'd mound a little soil to rebury them, but they keep popping up. What was going on there? It was probably your soil in your raised bed settling. So if you watched our video on topping off your raised beds a couple of weeks ago, we filled the bottom of the bed here, and on our new raised bed, we did the same thing with some twigs and leaves and that type of thing. And as those break down, your soil settles, which will tend to expose some of the roots of your plants. So yeah, you're doing exactly the right thing. Just keep adding some soil, adding some compost around the base of your plants. That's fine. It could also be, maybe it's a little bit windy, your peppers are kind of moving around in the raised bed, which will, you know, kind of pull them up a little bit from the soil. So just keep it up, and it's no problem to add some more soil around your pepper plants. In fact, these plants here, the roots were so exposed when we topped off the bed, because we had to add probably a good 6 inches of new fresh compost and fresh soil to this bed just a few weeks ago when we did that video. The roots were super exposed, but I went ahead and raised the soil level up. And so far, so good on the pepper plants. It's not bothering or hurting them at all. So yeah, good suggestion there to go ahead and do that. Gleam in Grace, my faves are Serrano and Habanero. I'm growing Hungarian wax and poblano this year too. So excited about those. Wow, you've got a good hot pepper garden going for sure. You're gonna love those, especially if you make pepper jelly, or I think it was, maybe it was Gardener Tom mentioned in the pre-chat live stream, or the pre-live stream chat that he likes chili rellenos, which poblanos make delicious chili rellenos. So you're going to have tons of delicious recipes from that. I can't wait to have peppers on our wood fire pizza. That's one thing I'm really looking forward to. I switched our salsa garden up to a pizza garden. A lot of you are growing in the April subscription box. That month's box was a pizza garden theme, and really enjoying and can't wait for the green zebra tomatoes that were in there, the purple peppers. It's going to be fun just to go over and grab some and pop it right on our pizza. So let me know if you're excited about that too. And also, if you've gotten your May subscription box, I want to hear about that in the chat as well. We've had lots of emails and Instagram comments that you're getting those in the mail. If you haven't got it yet, there is a limited supply. It's a great theme this month. Should I go ahead and say the theme? Because I know a lot of you have already talked about it on social media. The theme for this month is Grow a Power Producer Garden. There's vegetables in there that will power it right through the summer. And the seeds in the box are very special, unique seeds, especially this month. And they're not in any of my other seed collections. You're not going to want to miss it. They are great ones. So grab that, and over at our website, CallieKimGardenAtHome.com, you can get $7 off with the code GROWYOURGROCERY. So I want to hear it in the chat too, if you've gotten yours in the mail yet. Okay, Garden State Gardener. I'm growing around 600 varieties of hot peppers. Oh my goodness, wow. You must have a huge property to be able to grow that many peppers. That is a ton. Let us know what you're going to do with all those peppers. Do you have like a farmer's market or anything like that? That would be a great thing to do with all those peppers as well. Excuse me. Okay, Robbie and Gary, gardening easy. I agree on the pizza garden. Yeah, it's really going to be a lot of fun, that pizza garden. And a lot of people are really particularly enjoying that box. And Candace Stone says, I'm not a stuffed pepper fan, but I just like to eat the peppers raw. I would tend to agree with you on that one, Candace. We actually, one of the biggest ways we eat them is on the grill, or just slice them up and then like dip them in hummus or things like that. So I'd say grilled, roasted, or with hummus are probably our favorite ways to eat them. Ramona Jolly, I'd better get mine today. Hopefully it'll come in the mail, Ramona. Today it's for my birthday on the 31st. Well, happy birthday. And it was great that you got that for a birthday present for yourself. It'll be just in time to get those ready. You'll be growing and harvesting those vegetables in no time. Okay, let's see if there's another question we can answer before we head into the next tip. I can't find Thai peppers. You know, I'm not too sure where you could find those. I know Baker Creek Seed has tons of different varieties, and I bet they would have some type of a Thai pepper over there. They've got a lot of really beautiful colored ones, sweet to hot, all kinds of, a big, huge range of peppers over there. Okay, our last tip on peppers here, I believe it's our last tip. Oh, no, I got two last tips left, is support with a cage or a stake. And I kind of mentioned this already. You definitely do want to support your peppers. They do have rather fragile stems. So once they get loaded down with fruit, these stems can very easily snap. And I can see here, actually, this one is already developing a little fruit, which I would actually recommend. If you've got a pepper plant that you haven't transplanted yet and you want it to come to size, I would recommend pinching this little fruit off. Now, this will be a very little mild jalapeno, especially if it's tiny. And I'm also going to pinch off these flowers, because that way it'll send all the plant's energy into producing leaves and getting bigger rather than into producing the peppers. So you definitely do need to stake them or cage them. And like I mentioned, one of my favorite things to use is these small tomato cages, but you could also just use like a cedar stake. You could even use a trellis like that, but you would have to tie the plants to the trellis, if you use just a trellis, with this little stretchy tie tape here. When you use a cage, it's a lot easier because you don't have to tie it to anything as it grows. It just kind of makes it a little less maintenance. So that's really my favorite thing to do. And then you can put your cages fairly close together to accommodate the closeness of the pepper, how close the peppers are growing. So definitely use a cage or a stake. And I highly recommend that you do that when you plant your peppers, because that way you won't be stuck with trying to fit that cage over a larger size pepper plant as it grows, and then you might end up breaking off some of the stems. So if you can, just general rule of thumb, I don't always follow it myself, but I try to, is go ahead and install your trellises or your cages over your pepper plants when they plant. It's going to save you a lot of trouble lately. Later, believe me, I've done it many a time. So I speak from experience on that one. Okay, Jenna, here we are, Jen. Any particular recommendation on staking peppers in the green stock? Yeah, I think they might be a little bit too small in the green stock to fit a tomato cage in. You may just want to try some stakes, like the cedar stakes that you would get at your garden center. You could probably just put that in behind each pepper plant and then use this stretchy tie tape, which, by the way, little hint on the garden goodie, there's some of this stuff in the May Grow Your Groceries with Callie Kim subscription box. Super handy. I almost always have it in my pocket in the garden, but you can just break it off. You don't need scissors or anything like that. And then you can just wrap your little pepper stem around those little stakes in the green stock. So I don't have a green stock. I haven't grown in one of those before, but you might just want to try out a couple of those and see if that works. And then do make sure you come back and let us know how that's working for you. Okay, let's see here. Any other questions before we move on? We always do cages for our peppers, Anaheims and Poblanos. Usually they get over 3 feet tall. With the cages, we tie the cages to a T-post with zip ties. Okay, so that's a great idea too. So there, yes, peppers can get quite tall, especially if you are up to probably 3 or 4 feet tall, especially if you're very consistent with your fertilizing. They definitely will be super heavy and loaded down, and you definitely want to support them. So it's a great idea to, get a T-post set up there and really get some good, strong supports for your peppers. Again, don't need to do a big, huge, like tomato type support, but usually the small little tomato cages are sufficient. Okay. Last tip here that we have for the day is, and several people saying they love that stretchy tie tape. It's just the greatest stuff. It's super handy, and you can reuse it too if you carefully, untie it and reuse it when you're done with it with one plant. Okay, this is probably one of my favorite tips for peppers, and that is probably for anything in the garden. A lot of people think that peppers love the hot weather, and they do. However, once the temperatures get, I'd say 90, even 95, I like to put shade cloth over them, because the problem is when it gets that hot, the plants really do get stressed. The flowers will dry up, drop off, and the flower is where the pepper fruit is going to be produced. So once that flower dries up from the heat and drops off, you're kind of starting over with your pepper production. It can really slow things down. So for those of you that live in Arizona, Texas, I know a lot of you are already getting into the 90s, make sure you have your shade cloth ready. And I know Patricia, pretty much in Arizona there, pretty much grows under shade cloth all summer long, has a shade cloth structure over her garden, and it really allows her to be able to grow when she might not normally be able to grow. So you Florida gardeners, Texas, Arizona, all you southern gardeners, keep that shade cloth handy, even now in the early spring, because now is when your plants are really starting to develop. Their roots might quite not be strong enough. And even here in California, we could get, I think this weekend, it's gonna be in the close to 90. So for my new seedlings, especially, I will be covering those with shade cloth. But keep it handy all summer long. And when you hit those 95 degree days plus, all you have to do is just throw it over your cages here. And as long as you have it and you're armed and ready to deal with the heat, your peppers will thank you, and you don't have to kind of run out and run all over the place trying to find some shade cloth. So a great place to buy it is Amazon. They've got lots of different sizes, lots of different percentages of sunblock. It can be like from a 40% block on up to a 60, 70, and if you really want like dense shade for your patio or whatever, they even have shade cloth that's like 80 or 90%. But usually I use about a 60% shade block on a hot day, and it seems to work just fine. Got links in the video description. You can also grab it from your garden center. So just have some ready, and that way you're ready for it, avoids disappointment, and will really do a lot for saving your peppers and your other vegetables on hot days. It can stay about 10 to 15 degrees cooler under the shade cloth, which can really make or break your pepper production and help you grow a lot more this summer. So definitely keep it at the ready. Stephanie Rivera says, I love peppers. White habanero is a new one for me this year. Wow, that'll be fun. I always grow white lakes I do not know how to say that word. And shishitos for my sweet and for my hot chili pin and some kind of roasting pepper. It's nice to have a variety, isn't it, Stephanie? Get your hots and your sweets, and that way you've got all kinds of different things, or you can make your hot salsa, your mild salsa, whichever you like. I think one of our favorite things to make out of garden fresh tomatoes and peppers is a pico de gallo, which is just a raw salsa. It's super easy to make. Just chop up your tomatoes, your peppers. Throw in some onions in there if you've got cilantro, squeeze a lime, salt and pepper, and you can make salsa in about 5 minutes, and it's fresh, it's raw, it's just absolutely delicious. So let me know if you've ever tried that, because it's one of our favorite things to make and snack on in the summertime. Okay, we've got a few minutes left. Oh, you know what? Let me just mention before we jump off, before we answer the last questions, is harvesting peppers, super easy. However, you don't want to just yank the peppers from the vine, because again, or from the stem. The stems are kind of fragile, so you definitely want to grab your pepper in one hand. In fact, these here, I kind of do need to take these peppers off, even though I love the fact this plant already has peppers, but it's a small plant. So I would just grab the plant in one hand, the pepper in the other, and pull it right off. Don't yank it from the vine, because that can really damage your plant. So do be careful when you harvest, and that way you have lots of peppers growing and lots that you can continue to harvest through the summertime. Okay, Irene says pico de gallo is her favorite. It is the best, and it's just so fresh. And I think the fun thing about it is you can really add whatever you have in the garden. So it's pretty fun when you have different colors of things to make it nice and bright. Different colors of tomatoes and peppers. The bunching onions are great in there, the chives. And if your onions are growing to full size, of course, you can chop up those and put them in. You can season it how you want. So it's just a really fun, kind of all-encompassing type of little garden recipe. I don't take tons of time to cook, but I do like really, really simple garden fresh meals. I think simple is really the best. It works with like the time that we have. We'd love to grill outside. So, however, I can wander around and pick my veggies and then make them fresh right there is all that much easier. Okay, Connie Davidson, great suggestion here. She says, here in the Texas heat, I'm using 90% shade cloth on part of my garden. So yeah, definitely might be necessary when you get that hot. I'm sure you get well over 100 degrees many times to really just block out a lot of the sun and still let them get sun, but just not be quite so intense. Okay, Toka says, I have a question. Some of my pepper plants only produce 1 to 2 fruit, which ripen really slowly. Any idea why? I would totally get consistent with the fertilizing. Definitely they need just a little bit more feeding to really start pumping the peppers out. Now, it also does depend on where you live. If you live in a climate that's fairly cool temperatures, for example, my sister lives in on the coast of Oregon. They don't really get enough heat for peppers unless she grows them in a greenhouse. So they just built a greenhouse and things are really taken off there. So they really do like temperatures of 70 to 90 degrees pretty consistently to really start producing. I'd say even favoring warmer in the high 70s, 80s, and up to 90. So if it's not warm enough where you live, you may want to consider getting a small little greenhouse, even a little pop-up greenhouse, if you want to grow those really heat-loving vegetables. And you might see a big difference with that. But definitely get consistent with that fertilizing, and I think you'll see a difference there too. Okay, let's take one more question before we sign off for the day. I really appreciate everyone's suggestions as far as varieties. It's pretty fun to see what everyone is growing, and it really sounds like the chat crew here is growing the rainbow of colors and eating the rainbow of colors, which is always fun to see. And let's see here if I can scroll through and find one more to answer. All of this is making me hungry. Hurry up, peppers. Yeah, I'm really impatient for my peppers to ripen up and start growing as well, so we can pop them on the grill and in our pizza oven. I think that'll be a lot of fun. Okay, let's see. Patricia, I'm using less shade cloth since my Palo Verde tree has gotten so big and provides afternoon shade. That's great. That's a great strategy to use in a hot climate. And hopefully, you all saw our partial shade raised bed video the other day, where sometimes the vegetables and herbs especially don't like that intense afternoon heat and will do really well in a partial shade garden. So if you missed that video, go back and watch it. It's a really fun one, and you're not going to want to miss the new trellis that I built, that actually camera guy and I built together. It's really beautiful and definitely one of my favorite new additions to the garden this year. So you know what? We're going to close it off for today, guys. What a fun live stream. I can tell you all really love growing peppers. So I think we're going to have to do some more videos on peppers and how to grow them and more tips on that. But thank you so much for hanging out with us here on a Monday afternoon, a beautiful day here in California. And be watching for a couple more videos this week. We'll be back again next Monday. And don't forget to pick up your May Grow Your Grocery subscription box before they sell out over at CaliKimGardenAndHome.com. Jerry, thanks for bringing Mac on today for a little cameo. Did he already go upstairs?
He's upstairs in the
shade. Okay, in the shade. All right, guys, have a great week.
Bye,
and
everybody.
We will see you next Monday.
Thanks for all the likes. Bye.